Although it should be unnecessary to mention it by now, let us emphasize for the sake of clarity that these seven regions of the same world do not represent distinct and separate areas. Just as follows, fluid and gaseous substances intermingle in the physical world, burning desires, photosensitivity, and the forces of the world reduces and penetrates in the soul world. On the physical level, it penetrates on life signs on bodies. Same thing happens with pleasure and displeasure, and with soul light. Something similar is also true of active soul power and soul light. The three worlds 109. 2. The soul and the soul world after death. The human soul is the connecting link between the human spirit and the human body. Its forces of sympathy and antipathy, which through their interplay bring about the soul's expressions of desire, sensitivity, wish, pleasure and displeasure, so on, are not only active between soul formations, but also express themselves in relationship to the beings of the other worlds, the physical and the spiritual. While the soul is living in a body, it participates to some degree in everything that goes on in this body. When the functions of the physical body are proceeding smoothly, pleasure and comfort arise in the soul, but when these functions are disturbed, displeasure and pain appear. But the soul also takes part in the spirit's activities. One thought fills it with joy, another with disgust. It evolves a correct judgment and disapproves of a false one. A person's level of development depends on whether his or her soul leans more in the one direction or in another. Individuals are the more nearly perfect the more their souls sympathize with manifestations of the spirit, the less perfect the more their soul's inclinations are satisfied through bodily functions. The spirit is at the center of each human being, and the body is the instrument through which the spirit observes and knows, and also acts in, the physical world. The soul, however, mediates between the two. For example, it releases the sensation of tone from the physical impressions that air vibrations make on the ear, and then it experiences pleasure in this tone. It imparts all this to the spirit, which... 16. 17. 110 Theosophy. Grows in its understanding of the physical world as a result. A thought that appears in the spirit is converted by the soul into the wish to bring the thought into being, and only then, with the help of the bodily instrument, can the thought become an accomplished deed. We human beings can live up to our calling only by letting all of our activity be directed by the spirit. Left to itself, the soul can as easily turn its inclinations toward the physical world as toward the spiritual. Its feelers, so to speak, extend down into the physical as well as up into the spirit. Through this extension into the physical world below, the soul's own essential being is permeated and colored by the nature of this physical world. And since the spirit can only work in the physical world by means of the soul's mediation, the spirit itself points in the direction of the physical. Its formations are drawn toward the physical through the forces of the soul.
Left to itself, the soul can as easily turn its inclinations toward the physical world.
as for the spiritual, its feelers, so to speak, extend down into the physical as well as up into the spirit. Through this extension into the physical world below, the soul's own essential being is permeated and colored by the nature of this physical world. And since the spirit can only work in the physical world by means of the soul's mediation, the spirit itself points in the direction of the physical. These formations are drawn toward the physical through the forces of the soul. Consider undeveloped human beings. Their soul's inclinations are closely linked to their bodily functions. They experience pleasure only through the impressions the physical world makes on their senses. Even their mental activity is completely drawn down into this sphere. Their thoughts serve only to satisfy the needs of their physical existence. But as the spiritual self proceeds from incarnation to incarnation, its orientation is meant to be provided increasingly by the spirit, its knowledge determined by the spirit of eternal truth and its activity by eternal goodness. 18. Death is a fact of the physical world that signifies a change in the functioning of the body. At death to body. Supreme Rules 111. Seems to be a vehicle for a soul and a spirit, and from then on its functions become totally subject to the physical world and physical laws. It passes into the physical world in order to disintegrate in it. Our physical senses can observe only what happens to the body after death, what happens to the soul and spirit in them. Even when a person is alive, the soul and spirit can be observed only to the extent that they take on an outer manifestation in physical processes. After death, this is no longer possible. Therefore, sciences based on physical sense perception do not apply to the destiny of the soul and spirit after death. At this point, a higher form of knowledge appears, a knowledge based on the observation of processes taking place in the soul and spirit worlds. After freeing itself from the body, the spirit is still linked to the soul. Just as the body bound it to the physical world during physical life, the soul now binds it to the soul world. But the spirit's ultimate being is not to be found in this soul world, whose purpose is only to link it to its field of activity, to the physical world. To be able to reappear in more perfected form in a new incarnation, the spirit must draw energy and strength from the spiritual world. So, however, the spirit has been entangled in the physical world, bound up with the soul being permeated and colored by physical nature, and it also goes on this orientation itself. After death, the soul is no longer bound to the body but only to the spirit. It then lives in a soul environment, and only the forces of the soul world can influence it. To begin, 19. 1 Theosophy. The spirit is bound to the soul's life in the soul world, just as it is bound to the body through the physical incarnation. The moment of the body's death is determined by the body's own laws. In general, the soul and spirit do not leave the body. It is rather dismissed by them for when its forces can no longer function as the human physical organization requires. The same thing applies to the relationship between soul and spirit. The soul will release the spirit into the higher world, the spiritual world, when the soul's forces no longer function as the human soul organization requires. The spirit is set free as soon as the soul surrenders to dissolution everything it can experience only in the body, and retains only what is able to live on with the spirit. This remainder, although experienced in the body, can be imprinted on the spirit as the fruits of a lifetime, and links the soul to the spirit in the purely spiritual world. To become familiar with the soul's fate after death, we must observe the process of its dissolution. Its task had been to orient the spirit toward the physical, and as soon as this task is fulfilled, the soul itself moves in the direction of the spiritual. Because of the nature of its task, it would actually be immediately obliged to be only spiritually active once the body falls away from it and it can. 4. Publisher's note. This passage reads, they are rather dismissed by it, in the 19th Stuttgart 1922 through 26th Stuttgart 1948 editions. In all editions since the 27th Stuttgart 1955, the wording of the 1st through 18th editions has been restored. It is not certain that the changes introduced in 1922 stem from the author, so both versions have been presented here. The three ropes 113. No longer be a connecting link. This would happen if the soul had not been influenced by the body for a whole lifetime and had not been drawn towards the body in its own inclination. Without the coloring it assumes through being bound up with the body, the newly disembodied soul would immediately start to obey only the laws of the spirit and soul world. would be the case if the person in question had lost all interest in the earthly world before dying, if all the desires, wishes and so on linking the individual to the physical existence left behind had been satisfied. But to the extent that this is not the case, what remains of this orientation clings to the soul. To avoid confusion at this point, we must clearly distinguish between something that binds a person to the world in a way that can be resolved in a future incarnation, and something that binds that individual to one particular incarnation, namely the most recent one. In the first case, the situation is resolved by karma, in the second, it can only be discarded by the soul after death. For the human spirit, death is followed by a time in which the soul strips itself of its inclinations toward physical existence so that it can once again obey only the laws of the spirit and soul worlds and can set the spirit free. Of course, this takes longer in cases where the soul has been more tightly bound to the physical. It takes little time in cases of individuals who have not been very attached to physical life, longer in cases of those whose interests were totally bound up with that life and who therefore still have many desires, wishes and so on present in their souls at death. 20. 21. 114 Theosophy. 22. 23. Gaining an idea of the state in which the soul lives during the time right after death will be easiest if we take a fairly crass example, for instance, the pleasure of a gourmet. This pleasure, of course, is not of the body but of the soul, and that both the pleasure and the desire for this pleasure belong to the soul. However, satisfying this desire requires the corresponding bodily organs, palate, taste buds and so on. After death, the soul does not immediately lose its desire, but the physical organs that used to be the means of satisfying it are no longer there. The person in question then experiences something similar to suffering from extreme thirst in an area where there is no water for miles around. Although the reason for the suffering is different, its effects are similar but much stronger. Because of the lack of the physical organs through which pleasure was experienced, the soul suffers burning pain at being deprived of this pleasure. The pain applies to any of the soul's desires that can be satisfied only by means of physical organs. This state of burning deprivation can be called the place of desires, although of course it is not an actual place. It lasts until the soul has learned to stop craving what can be provided only by the body. When the soul enters the soul world after death, it is subject to the laws that prevail there, and their effects determine how the soul's inclination toward the physical will be eliminated. The effects will have to be different according to the types of soul substances and forces involved, but each type will make its cleansing and purifying influence felt. The process is such that any antipathy, the three worlds 115, and the soul is gradually overcome by the forces of sympathy, and the sympathy itself is taken to the ultimate degree. At this highest level of sympathy toward all the rest of the soul world, an individual soul merges with the rest, becomes one with it, with self-seeking exhausted. It ceases to exist as a being inclined toward physical, sensory existence, and through this the spirit is set free. The soul undergoes purification in all the regions of the soul world described previously, until in the region of perfect sympathy it becomes one with the soul world in general. Because the spirit has spent a lifetime in intimate association with the soul, it is bound to it until the very last moment of liberation. Having been directly linked to the soul, which was its very life, the spirit is much more closely related to it than to the body, to which it was linked only indirectly, through the soul. The spirit is bound to the soul that is gradually freeing itself, but not to the disintegrating body. Because it has a direct link to the soul, the spirit can only feel free of the soul once the soul has become one with the soul world in general. As the human being's residence during the time immediately after death, the soul world can be called the place of desires. The different religious systems that have incorporated an awareness of this situation into their teachings know this. Place of desires, under different names such as purgatory, the fire of purification, and so on. The soul world's lowest region is the region of burning desire, where the soul's greatest self-serving desires goes. 24. 25. 116 Theosophy. Relating to the lowest aspect of bodily life, are eliminated after death. Through such desires, the soul can experience the effect of this region's forces. These forces take as their point of attack all the unfulfilled desires that remain in the soul from physical life. The sympathy in such a soul extends only to what will nourish over anything else. However, after death its desires focus on physical pleasures that cannot possibly be satisfied in the soul world, and this impossibility intensifies its greed to the greatest possible degree. At the same time, however, this impossibility gradually extinguishes the greed. The burning lusts and desires slowly consume themselves, and the soul learns from experience that eliminating these lusts is the only way to prevent the suffering that must stem from them. During physical life, such desires are repeatedly satisfied, effectively controlling the pain of burning deep behind the shrine of illusion. After death, however, in the final of purification, this pain is fully exposed, and the corresponding deprivation must be suffered to the full. This is indeed a dark state of affairs for the soul. Of course, only individuals whose desires focus on the surface pain in physical life fall into this state. Those with full desires, on the other hand, little connection to the reason of burning desire and fasting without those fears. It must be stated that the soul spending the longest time under the influence of this reason arose through the pain once related to its fire during physical life and therefore has the greatest need to be purified in it. Supreme Rules 117. Since the soul actually longs for its own purification after death, we should not regard this purification as suffering in the sense of any comparable experience in the world of the senses. It is the only way to move affection remaining in the soul from being eliminated. Processes of a second type take place in the soul world, processes in which sympathy and antipathy are imbalanced. A human soul in this condition is influenced after death by these processes for a period of time determined by the extent to which it gave itself in life to superficial frivolity, and suffers of transitory sense impressions into an influence of daily trivialities that typify this condition. They let themselves be influenced by every daily triviality, but the influences fade quickly since their sympathy is not extended to any one thing in particular. Anything not belonging to this trivial realm is antipathetic to them. After death, when the soul in this condition lacks the sense perceptible physical things needed for satisfaction, the condition but slowly die off. Naturally, the deprivation that prevails before it is soon extinguished in the soul causes suffering. Are those in which sympathy and the wish-like character prevail. Our souls experience the effects of these processes through everything that maintains an atmosphere of wishing after death. This wishing, too, gradually dies off because of the impossibility of satisfying it. 26. 27. 118. But this level of the soul world is the level of soul light. Here, sympathy for others already carries considerable weight. It's also related to these reasons to the extent that these display and pleasure in their surroundings during physical life, rather than giving themselves up to satisfying their lower needs. Put under zone purification here in Kumu, for instance, a sense of sober enthusiasm for nature, which must be distinguished from a lofty living in nature that is pure human character and seeks the spirit that reveals itself in the things and processes of nature. This higher feeling for nature is among the things that contribute to the development of the spirit and establish something permanent in it. This must be distinguished from a sense-based pleasure in nature which leads to soul and need its purification as much as any other information based on pure sympathy and distances. Many people idealize practical arrangements that serve our sense of well-being, such as a system of education that leads to sense of comfort above all else. We cannot say that these people are serving only their own self-centered impulses. Nevertheless, their souls are still oriented to the sense-perceptible world and must be cured of this tendency by means of the power of sympathy that prevails from the fifth region of the soul world, where any external means of satisfaction is lacking. Here, the soul gradually recognizes that this sympathy must take other. 120 Theosophy. Direction. Sympathy for its soul surroundings must prompt the soul to pour itself out into soul space. Those souls who expect their religious observances to enhance their sensuous well-being are also purified here, regardless of whether they yearn for an earthly or for a heavenly paradise. We find this paradise in the soul world, but only in order to recognize its worthlessness. Of course, these are all only individual examples of purification undergone in this fifth region, many more to be added. 31. 32. The purification of the part of the soul that needs perhaps in takes place in the sixth region for reason of active soul power. Although this action is not egotistical in character, it is still motivated by the sensuous satisfaction that it provides. The type of people who develop this pleasure and activity give the outward appearance of being idealists and self-sacrificing individuals, but on a deeper level they are still motivated by the craving of sensuous pleasure. Many artistic people, as well as those who devote themselves to scientific activities for the pleasure of it, belong in this region. What binds them to the physical world is their belief that art and science is used to receive such pleasure. The seventh region, that is the actual soul light, frees us from our last inclinations toward the center in the physical world. Each preceding region has absorbed that aspect of the soul that is related to it. All that is left surrounding the spirit is the belief that its activity should be fully devoted to the physical world. Many extremely gifted people think about little else than events in the physical. The three worlds 121. World, here for reason can be called materialism. In the seventh region, these beliefs must be entered destroyed. Our souls realize that, in absolute reality, a materialistic point of view is without objects, and their materialistic beliefs melt away like ice in the sun. The being of the soul is now absorbed into its own world, and the spirit, free of all restraint, views its way upward into nature to meet the blue sky and its own element. The spirit has created its most recent earthly gas, and in the time that has elapsed from death, every aspect of this past remaining of the marvelous spirit has evolved. In overcoming this last earthly remnant, the soul has returned to its own element. From what has been described, we can see that experiences in the soul world and the circumstances of soul life after death become less and less repellent as we dispose of more and more of what still comes to us from our ancient immediate and affinity towards material existence. Depending on the circumstances created during its physical life, a soul will belong to the different regions for longer or shorter periods of time. Wherever it feels an affinity, it remains until the affinity is wiped out, but where no affinity exists, it passes through without feeling any of the possible effects. This section is intended to describe in broad strokes only the most basic features of the soul world and the nature of the soul's life within it. The same is true of the following description of the country of spirit beings. To describe further characteristics of these higher worlds would go beyond the limits of this book. Without going, 33. 122 Theosophy. Into very great detail, the phenomena of these higher worlds are for us appear to be the relationships that time spans cannot be discussed in an intelligible way, since these are all quite different from their counterparts in the physical world. Some important points are only your physical senses. We have to use comparisons and imagery to describe the full world, and that is even more the case here. Our language, which for the most part serves only the purposes of sense-perceptible reality, is not exactly richly endowed with expressions that can be applied directly to the country of spirit beings, so it is especially important to take much of what is said here as nothing more than indication. Everything described here is so different from the physical world, this is the only possible way of depicting it at all. Because of the inadequacy of our language, which is intended for communication in the physical world, the statements being made here can only. 5. An outline of occult science lesson, NY, Anthroposophic Press, 1972. The three rules 123. Simply correspond to actual experience in the spiritual field. It must be emphasized above all that this spiritual world is woven out of the substance that constitutes human thought, substance, in a very figurative